Get started. So we're very happy to have Joao, Magueijo here today. He did his PhD in Cambridge and is now at Imperial College, London. In the interim time, he was in Toronto for a couple of years, joint appointed here and at PI. And he's decided to give a Blackboard talk today, so that's, we're excited for that. Let's welcome him, thanks.
Thank you. So this is a talk which I decided to give as a Blackboard talk precisely because this does not sound very much a CITA talk. I'm going to talk about quantum gravity in a funny way. I'm going to talk about something which is called dynamical dimensional reduction in quantum gravity. So this sounds the kind of talk you give at perimeter, not the kind of talk you give here. But what I will try to do is show that this kind of somewhat unusual phenomenon is actually something very useful in cosmology. So you can actually do in a very, admittedly in a very unorthodox way, you can do cosmology to a great benefit for observations and predictability. Let's see if I get time to talk to you about the predictability issue. So you can actually do cosmology quite nicely with this recent idea that there is dynamical reduction in the UV. Okay, I'll explain that first of all, because that's kind of the most important thing. So as you know, in modern physics, the concept of dimension of space-time is a more fluid thing, you might think it is. So you're used to space-time being four-dimensional. Could it be bigger than four? Could it be smaller than four? So let's have a poll here. Who thinks it's four? Who thinks it's bigger than four? String theories have made their inroads here, I see. And smaller than four. Okay, I'm the minority one, okay? So clearly if you, exactly, I'm not surprised by the result, okay? So this is what we see. Some people believe that what we see is all there is, and it's a fair way to do things. You certainly have heard about this idea, which is very old. You don't need string theory to introduce this idea. Sometimes it's convenient as theorists to introduce more dimensions. And then why do we only see four? Well, you have to compactify. In fact, you don't even have to compactify. There's ways of doing things such that you don't see the extra dimensions. So what I'm going to talk about today is actually this unusual thing. This is something which obviously, small than two dimensions, I mean, that's a bit crazy, because you can compactify the other dimensions, you cannot compactify the other ones. So, you know, if you have two, well, this idea of holography, we're really a hologram, okay? So you could be, that's one way in which dimensions could be fewer than ones we see. Maybe we are a hologram, and it looks like we have four dimensions, but we're not. But that's not really what I'm going to talk about today. I'm going to talk about some ideas which appear in quantum gravity, showing that dimensionality is something that runs. So you are in the infrared, you go to the ultraviolet. This is an idea you probably know in particle physics and in quantum field theory. For example, the coupling constants run. Depends on what energy scale you're probing them. And they run, right? They run with the energy. So what has been found in quantum gravity is that it's possible that you run from 4 to 2 as you probe space-time into bigger and bigger, into smaller and smaller length scales and bigger energies. So this is the idea. This was found first in something called causal dynamical triangulations. And then it was rediscovered in many different fields. It was rediscovered in other approaches to quantum gravity, like spin foams, causal sets, things which I'm sure you've never heard of, but asymptotically safe Einstein quantum gravity, that kind of thing. So there's all these acronyms which represent lifetimes of people trying to quantize gravity. And it looks like this phenomenon is ubiquitous. Now, it could be just a bandwagon effect, okay? There's a sociology thing here. One person finds it, everyone finds it again. Or it could be that there is something fundamental about these theories that actually space-time does run to two. So one thing which, you know, you probably have heard about is Ojava-Lifshitz. Who has heard about Ojava-Lifshitz? You did, obviously. Okay, Ojava-Lifshitz is one example in which you do see this phenomenon. And in particular, in that case, it is very closely related to the fact that the graviton has this dispersion relation. So if you have the energy and momentum of the graviton, at low energies, E equals P, because the mass is zero. Well, in fact, I'm going to put a mass here, because later on I'm going to generalize this. So it could be that I have this kind of relation for here. In fact, let me put 2 gamma here, with gamma equals 2 for Ojava-Lifshitz. And somehow this modified dispersion relation, represents running of the dimensionality from 4 to 2. I'll explain exactly how. So one way in which these things were found is using some concept called spectral dimension. So quantum gravity is really weird. I can't see why people at CITA don't talk to people at Perimeter doing quantum gravity. It's because what they come up with is things which are beautiful mathematically. They're not even remotely connected with reality. So they're not even manifolds. The quantum geometries, which have nothing to do with observables. And yet you can define dimensionality on them. And you do crazy things called the spectral dimension. What you do is you have a minus plus 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 space-time. You Euclideanize these. You introduce a fictitious time. Then you put things going around. You imagine a fictitious diffusion process going around the space. You can always define these, even if you have a crazy spin foam. Space-time is a foam and so on. You can actually still define these, and you find this phenomenon. This is really not very nice. So what I'm going to say now is really not applicable generally, but it's applicable if you want to do science. This was terrible. So of course, you're doing science as well. It's applicable. I'm actually being recorded. I keep forgetting. But what I mean to say is if you want to do low-energy science, low-energy physics, which connect to observations, this is really not very helpful. This is actually a much more helpful description. The proviso here is this thing, this phenomenon, is found in things which don't even have a manifold-like structure, let alone having plane waves, let alone having dispersion relations. But if you do have plane waves, and if you have dispersion relations, you can find that this guy here, applicable to this diffusion process, does mimic this. OK, you don't need to go there. So let me just give you a very simplistic way to see how this dispersion relation represents dimensional reduction. This is how you do cosmology. So without this guy, in fact, the whole dimensional reduction thing is irrelevant except for this guy here, which is all I need to do cosmology. So another proviso added here. The reason why this represents dimensional reduction is the following. This thing can always be trivialized. So we have a modified dispersion relation. I can always define new energies of energy and momentum such that square root. Then you just obtain this guy. OK, and this is an argument I've heard so many times. OK, you can see what's coming here. The kind of cosmology I'll be doing is called varying speed of light cosmology because this thing has a varying speed of light. So if you have an energy-momentum relation, which is non-trivial, this is the group speed of your waves. And you can prove that this thing for those dispersion relations goes like this. So the energy, the speed of light varies with the momentum like a p-square for Ojava-Lifshitz theory. In fact, here is the speed of the graviton. But if you say this is true for massless particles, it's the same. I never actually wrote the m-square here. Sorry about that. So this is zero for massless particles, but not otherwise. Now, varying speed of light theories are a weird thing. I mean, I used to think that every time I gave this talk, a talk on varying speed of light, it felt a bit like I was talking with my flies undone. I mean, it was like embarrassment. Everyone thought, this guy's crazy. And these things have changed for reasons which I will mention here. So there's actually a bunch of predictions in cosmology which you can make in a very interesting way that connects with quantum gravity, unlike with inflation. But a more scientific, so less sociological thing is that you can always redefine the units to make C equals 1. And in fact, I just did this there. So it's obviously true. In the Brendsicki theory, we have a varying G. You can always redefine the units so that G is a constant, although you have a varying G. So you probably know this if you've seen Brendsicki theories. They're called two frames. There's the Einstein frame and the Jordan frame, I believe it's called. So the kind of game I'm playing here is obviously that one. I can always redefine my units and have a frame in which I have a varying C, a frame in which I don't have a varying C. I can never get rid of the non-trivial effects. I'm just shifting effects around. Okay. So in Brendsicki theories, if you make G a constant, you have non-minimal coupling to matter. You have a fifth force. So this is the price you pay for having a constant G. The two things are equivalent. Do whatever one is easiest for you. So there's no constant or varying G in absolute. But of course, the phenomenology has to be somewhere. So it's exactly what I'm doing here. So I'm basically trivializing the C. And this is interesting because you see what happens to the measure. The measure is dE dP p square. Okay. And this thing, if I if I just go through the calculation, it's a trivial calculation. You find that d mu tilde does go to be d tilde dp tilde. So more generally, if I put a d here minus 1, and if I keep the gamma there, and if I have this guy here, this goes into d1 plus gamma minus 1, which is exactly the Ojava-Lifshitz formula, if you've seen it. So some people here have seen Ojava-Lifshitz. What you really have is that your asymptotic dimension is 1 plus d over 1 plus gamma when d equals 3, gamma equals 2, which is this 2 that appears there. Then my asymptotic d is 2. So this is one example in which you know that you go from 4 to 2. There's many examples. This is not the only dispersion relation that does that. I'll mention more in a bit. And this is a simple way to prove that I'm representing dimensional reduction without going to this crazy idea of spectral dimension, which I grant, you know, it's true, I admit, I accept that it's things you need if you don't actually have dispersion relations. But if you do have dispersion relations, you see it. Basically, what you're doing is, instead of using the spectral dimension, I'm using the Hausdorff dimension of the measure in units in which I trivialize the dispersion relations. Okay, so initially, I can either have a varying C or a varying volume element. If I have a varying volume element, I do have this reduction from 4 to 2. Choose your picture in both cases. You really have both, depends on the way you look at it. Okay, and you really have none, depending on the way you look at it. You have a relation between the two.
You know the theory that a lot of dispersion relation, and if you redefine the ease of these, then the measure, the power of the p in the measure is modified. And if you interpret that part as the dimension, yeah. it looks like it's with a different dimension.
That's right.
But the dimension not only shows up there. For example, like if you look at like how the flux number is concerned, for example, for those things, that's also where dimension comes in. But when you rewrite the whole thing in terms of the
new
p's and p's,
good point.
The same d shows up, or?
So this is the way the number of modes scales as I go larger and larger in momentum space. So I'm really counting modes, okay? So this shows up in thermodynamics, in black body radiation, all kinds of things, because this is actually what counts the modes as I go in bigger and bigger e's. So this is my measure of dimension. It's that in that sense, I have a different dimension. You're quite right. I mean, basically, if I started with 3 P1, P2, P3, I still have a P1, P2, P3 in there, right? So it's not in that sense, right? So it's in a very specific sense, which appears actually in statistical physics. So any calculation in kind of high energy thermodynamics using dispersion relations will measure this, not something else. And in fact, the fluctuations, we get there. So I'm going to be talking about fluctuations in cosmology. What I care about is that, this dimension. So the other thing is actually, this is more general, so I didn't say this, very important point. So I illustrated this with Ojava-Lifshitz, and you did say E and P, so sometimes this is not so trivial. Here the E and the P separate very nicely, right? This is very general, okay? So there's many theories in which I have 4 to 2 with dispersion relations. Sometimes I cannot distinguish how much is E, how much is P. So we have yet to find an example in which the spectral dimension result is different from this Hausdorff dimension, but sometimes it's the full energy momentum Hausdorff dimension that I mean. Any more questions? I'm going to be moving to cosmology, I hope, anyway. This is the quantum gravity bit. So it wasn't too painful, I hope, anyway. So this was kind of very simplified. I didn't actually go into any of the details, but that's essentially what I needed to say about
it. But it's the same metric. Is it fair to say that if I just take a shot in a black hole and I just, you know, depending on the metric I can choose to put the LAR as function of radius to go out to the E minus 1, for example, in a specific space time. And if depending on what I think I should be doing, you could find that my distance goes as out to some higher power of 2.
This is energy, you know. This is energy momentum dimensional.
That's right. Now, if you know how many modes there are on a shell, which is what you're doing here, you would also conclude that, you know, maybe I could describe the GR corrections to my Euclidean space-time as being a change in dimension if I just count how many modes
that's right.
close to the available as I get pulled
that's right.
in. So that's an accounting of dimension in a similar sense, I guess.
It is. That's right. That's right. That's exactly. Except this is an energy momentum space. Okay. That's right. It's exactly that. Okay, let's go on to cosmology then. I mean, so you can make this as complicated or as you want. This Ojava Lifshitz is particularly simple. I don't, people say Orava, isn't it here? Orava Lifshitz or something. Well, everyone mispronounces my name, so I think I can mispronounce anyone's name as well. So, but Ojava Lifshitz is. I hope you know what I'm talking about. Okay, at least you raised the hand, some of you, anyway. This does occur in causal dynamical triangulations. It's quite crazy because what you're really doing is path integrals of quantum geometries. You have nothing like this, you still find it. There are a bunch. This guy violates Lorentz invariance, by the way. I can come up with theories that don't violate Lorentz invariance, in which I have the form dispersion relations, but the form measure as well. We can represent 4 to 2. I can play this game. It still is the same. So in general, 4 to 2 can be done in many different ways. Ojava Lifshitz is the simplest one in which I have the form dispersion relations. But you always find this. You can always dial this guy somehow, or dial the parameters that you do get the right phenomenon. Okay, cosmology. Right, so this was work I did when I was here. I'll publish it later, but I was actually sharing. I was in between PI, Perimeter Institute, and CITA at some point when I was doing this work, and it was quite strange. This was like 2005, 2007. So every time I went to Perimeter, I was considered boring and mainstream because I looked at the sky. I looked at the data analysis you guys do, right? And every time I came here, I was a crank because I was doing quantum gravity. And so there was kind of a conflict between the two because I was doing both things. I think now I'll be a crank in both places because things have changed at PI as well. But I do think the kind of cosmology you do, I mean, in a way, it's orthogonal to inflation. But it's not that different from inflation the way you do the calculations. So the crucial thing which is different is that you're changing the structure of Lorentz invariance in a very radical way. As I said, you don't need to violate it. But you have to deform it, obviously. The philosophy is very different from inflation, because in inflation, you're really insulating quantum gravity from cosmology. Inflation was designed to do that. It was designed because you said, oh, I don't know what happens in the quantum epoch. I don't want my predictions to depend on that. So you slap in inflation. It just kind of erases all the initial conditions. This is the opposite. I mean, this is, in a way, what you should be doing. You should be embracing the Trans-Planckian problem if you want to test quantum gravity. So you're trying to plug in quantum gravity directly into the observables. It's a very different philosophy. So I don't think it's cranky at all. At least the problem is that quantum gravity is quite weird. But that's not the problem we're trying to connect the two. I think that's actually an attempt to make quantum gravity a science in the sense of observable science. So essentially, the idea is that if you have a varying C, it's a bit like having accelerated expansion, because you can solve the horizon problem. And I'm going to show actually how the calculations are very similar when you go from one regime to another. And effectively, what you have is, in some theories, we have a C of T that essentially does the job of accelerated expansion. So the usual Big Bang model has the problem, the modes start outside the horizon. So you don't have a way to set initial conditions. With accelerated expansion, they start inside the horizon. If you make the horizon big, because C is big initially, that does the same. So we play these games. I started this with Andy Albrecht ages ago. So we can actually play this game in a very conservative way, called bimetric theories. So you can say the speed of gravity and the speed of light are different. So that actually means I like Lorentz invariance so much I make two copies of it. So one for gravity, one for matter. And then I just say the light cones don't need to be conformal, don't need to be the same. That's one way to do it. That's not what I'm going to talk about today. I'm going to be talking about these guys. How I can use these guys to generate more or less the same effect. So in my mind, bimetric VSL is the thing which is the simplest way to do cosmology, but doesn't plug to quantum gravity, and that's what my talk is about. Now, this is non-trivial, because as I said, what you really have is this. So you have like what, you have, in a way, you have a rainbow in which, as I go from color to color, the different colors propagate at different speeds. So what I have from the form dispersion relations is a theory in which the speed of light depends on the momentum. And what I need is a time dependence. Now, the crucial point here, as a cosmologist, you should know this. We work with commoving wave numbers. So your P is actually commoving K divided by A of T. So as I focus on a given commoving K, the physical wavelength is changing with the expansion of the universe. So I'm actually probing the rainbow. with using the expansion of the universe. So by proxy, I have a time-dependent speed of light. If I have an energy-dependent speed of light, if I have an expanding universe. And it's essentially the, qualitatively is the only thing I need to get on with the calculation. So this is very simple, but very simple point, but an important ish. So I'm going to be doing the same calculation you do for inflation. And let me tell you the upshot. The upshot is that if I go from 4 to 2, the fluctuations have spectral index 1. And this is actually general. I'm going to be proving this for Ojava Lifshitz, but this is actually completely general. Okay, so it's an interesting thing. Basically, what I'm going to be doing is the same calculation, but not with these, with these, these via these. I will tell you the assumptions. The assumptions look quite specific for Ojava Lifshitz. In fact, they're not. I'll explain why they're more general. And in fact, this is a general result. Any theory which has 4 to 2, which is what you observe in quantum gravity, has exact scale invariant fluctuations, vacuum fluctuations, I should say. Okay, so the calculation, in the case of Ojava Lifshitz, is quite simple. You need to assume face value. In the end, you don't need to assume these. It looks like you do. You need to assume Einstein gravity, second order at least, and you need to assume a higher order derivative representation. This is actually not needed, but this is an assumption. To get on with the calculation, I'll explain this in a minute. If you do this, your second order action is the thing you find for inflation as well. So you have your d eta, dk, some kind of k, and then you end up with the usual thing. You have an a square, moving guy, c s square. This is a minus k square for the second order action. You have the usual transformation, which is v over a, and you end up with this equation, which you know from inflation. And it's true still here with these assumptions. And then something mysterious is going to happen with Ojava Lifshitz. And
you say that it's, there is a scalar field, or there's no scalar field?
It could be any curvature fluctuation. It could be a scalar field, yeah.
But it's something more than just metric.
The zeta, yeah, the zeta is the commoving. Yes, yes. But it doesn't need to be. This could be hydrodynamical, by the way. It could be hydrodynamical matter.
It could be something else. But there's something more.
Very important, very important. So I am saying, exactly, so this is very, it's not vacuum, right? So very important, Ojava Lifshitz, strict Ojava Lifshitz is the graviton, right? So this could be the H of the graviton, but it doesn't need, it could be just a metric, right? If it's the graviton. So strictly Ojava Lifshitz is just a tensor, right? So what I'm saying, what I'm assuming is that there is a dispersion relation which is similar for the scalars as well as for the tensors. But very important point, okay? It could be a scalar field, could be a hydrodynamical matter, could be whatever I want, but there has to be an extra assumption, which is, this is the same. So the fact that you get the same result is non-trivial and results from these assumptions, but there's going to be a funny thing in a minute, okay. So I'm sure you've seen this before. So this is effectively what you find. So normally you have a Z here, and Z is A over CS. The Z is just A in this case, turns out. This is usually 1, because the speed of sound in for a scalar field is 1 in inflation. It doesn't need to be a DBI inflation, it's not. But so bimetric VSL is not as well, but here it's also, you know, appears there. This CS here is basically the CS that appears from there, okay? So let me kind of erase this, because what I'm going to be doing now is, so you know what this is. This is basically, cosmology is cookery, right? All you're doing is cooking with this equation, in which I have an harmonic oscillator equation here. This guy is just pressure, okay? It's like a spring. And the CS here, why is it CS? Well, it's an acoustic wave. So it's the pressure of your fluid or your whatever, or if it's, that CS is obviously, well, it's whatever comes from here, right? In this case, there's an omega there. So it's a funny spring. It's a spring in which the speed of sound varies with the frequency. In general, the inflation is constant, but it doesn't need to be. The point remains, this guy here represents microphysics, represents inside your ISO modes, which are sensitive to the pressure, and therefore generate acoustic waves. This guy here represents an inverted harmonic oscillator. The sign is wrong, okay? So this is an instability. It's the gravitational instability. It's the Jeans instability. When things are too big, they want to clump. If something is an overdensity, it wants to attract more stuff and be even more overdense. So this is basically the Jeans instability, which happens when gravity wins. This is the outside horizon modes. So outside, horizon, gravity, acoustic waves or pressure waves inside the horizon. And you know what the problem is? The problem is, if you take the usual model of the Big Bang, C is 1 or whatever, it's a constant. This guy is conformal time, which appears there, goes from 0. This A double dot over, this A double prime over A is 1, is proportional to 1 over eta square, so it blows up at the Big Bang. So we have a constant here. You have something that blows up at the Big Bang. Everything starts outside the horizon. That's the horizon problem. Mathematically, in a very simple way, mathematically expressed. So what inflation does is effectively, so you have accelerated expansion, and this is a test of your undergraduate cosmology. What happens to conformal time if you have accelerated expansion? It's a technical issue, but it's important. You should know this. You don't know this.
Yeah, no, I do.
And then say the answer.
Oh, I thought about it as I'm not an undergrad.
But you were once. You were once. So it's negative, and it goes from minus infinity to 0. So you exactly change the time. This is what I mean by cookery. You're basically doing cooking in a funny way. You're basically inverting the timing of things in the normal Big Bang. So what inflation does. So what actually happens is, okay, so we have these two kind of modes. We have the modes that initially dominate. So they're initially inside the horizon, which is, in this case, for inflation, is just this. And you have the modes which are outside the horizon. So this equation, if I neglect this, integrates to V proportional to A. Okay? So inflation is really, let me just erase this. This is a very important point. I'm basically redoing the calculation for inflation to show that I'm not really doing anything very much different necessarily. So if you've done this in grad school, you know, you can solve these Bessel functions and so on. That's not very helpful. So what actually happens is, effectively, you can just cut and paste one regime and the other and see what happens. So in general, if V is proportional to A, that could be a function of K here. Okay? This is the modes that leave the horizon. This is the frozen in power spectrum, right? So this is what happens inside the horizon if I have, why is this square root of 2 omega? Let's see in the graduate physics. So it's quantum field theory, right? This is the bit which comes from quantum field theory for vacuum expectation values. This is the RMS. This is the thing you need to make sure, if my amplitudes are here, there'll be creation and annihilation operators when I quantize. So obviously, when I compute two-point functions, they give me like basically a constant or 1/2. And that's basically the reason why this is the RMS. This is what happens inside the horizon. This is what happens outside the horizon. Now, if you just glue the two, you can actually work out the power spectrum outside the horizon. Okay, inflation. That's the general blueprint for the calculation. Inflation, what happens? So it's very important, very different in the two cases, okay? With inflation, so I should have said, if this thing, this guy is varying, actually this is an integral of Cs d eta over k. In inflation, the Cs is actually a constant, so this is just e to the minus k eta divided by square root of k. And I have to match these when k eta is of order 1 with v proportional AF of K. So I'm doing a calculation in case you haven't seen this before. So what happens? Okay, I recall, what is scale invariance? Scale invariance is the statement. So I recall the spectral index is this, which means scale invariant is this, K to 3/2. Okay, this is the definition. In inflation, the vacuum fluctuations are not scale invariant when I start. So when I look at inside the horizon, they're not scale invariant. So what actually happens, and this is what I mean by the timing of cookery, is that you have genes instability, so things grow like A as they leave the horizon, but then things leave the horizon, different Ks leave the horizon at different times, so they've grown different amounts when I look at them at a later time. And what happens with inflation is that if A is proportional to 1 over eta, more or less, which is the CITA, then I can put this guy here, identify these with these, and it's just a simple algebra that this guy here must be like 1 over k to the 3/2. Because you pass this a to the other side, a is like 1 over eta, eta is like 1 over k, and I get the k to the 3/2. So very simple algebra, back of the envelope calculation, but this is essential for understanding why inflation produces scale invariant fluctuations. It's not in general. So accelerated expansion does not in general produce scale invariant fluctuations, and they're not scale invariant when you start. They become scale invariant if I'm near the CITA. Okay? Very important point, quite different from what happens in what I'm about to tell you. Your problems with this is just standard, but you know, this is standard but placed put in a way that's probably not Or you've seen this before. Okay, so here, so modified dispersion relations, let me call it this way. So the V is proportional to, now this is slightly different, but it doesn't really matter. So it's an integral of Cs d eta k, but this is just a phase, doesn't really matter. And I have 2 omega here, and this will match F proportional to A, F of k. You can see what happens. So this is y 4 to 2, which is related to that p cubed, that cs p square here, the exact which appears there, leads to scale invariance. So my omega is ck. My c is going to be lambda k over a square for anything which is like Ojava-Lifshitz. So 2 things happen here, OK? Inside the horizon, this guy is already scale invariant. But then in addition, because I have this a square here, which appears there, I have an a there, which matches exactly this one. So again, back of the envelope calculation, I love back of the envelope calculations. It's the only ones I can ever make. But basically, these guys cancel, and like in inflation. And something which is scale invariant inside the horizon just remains scale invariant outside the horizon. So the conclusion is that here I have scale invariance, whatever the equation of state. I don't need to be near the CITA, to be near radiation, to be near dust, could be any equation of state. Your A of T, your A of eta could be anything. And I still have, basically because the A is canceled, I still have scale invariant fluctuations. Any problem with this?
So people. Still need that this A double prime of A is, has a definitive sign and it's a number.
You still need what, say?
Mm-hmm. And you're going to say make C squared a function of eta, power of eta. And
that's right, yeah.
And just look at the equation. So now you said that you don't care about the double prime over A.
No.
So you just set it to zero, but that's just to get your scaling.
No. This thing is going to be some kind of equation of state dependent thing divided by eta squared. Yeah? So this guy, essentially what I'm saying is that the CS has got to drop faster than eta squared. Has got to blow up faster than eta squared. So that's the conditions for solving the horizon problem. But once that's true, this kind of behavior is true for any constant equation of state. Is your problem being constant or not being?
No. So that follows that the CS is a function of eta. But I'm just saying, your second, so normally in inflation, all normalization happens when these 2 terms are equal, when CS squared, K squared equal to A double time of A. That's when you normally solve for the matching.
That's right.
You're saying that if you make that a function of eta, what you do with the a double prime over a, you just say it's enough, it's zero? I mean, it's
No. What I'm saying is that basically, so this guy is whatever it is, but the normalization is done inside the horizon, and it just propagates outside the horizon. You don't actually get any kind of amplification, which is different. You already have the A factor inside the horizon, which you have outside the horizon. For Ojava-Lifshitz, so this is very important. If this guy here is not a 2, if it's something else, this is not true. So my scaling my spectral index is independent of the equation of state for Ojava-Lifshitz, and it's 1. If you go away from that, then it depends on both things. It depends on this power here, and depends on the equation of state. So it's a bit different. That's the thing. It's completely different from what happens in inflation. But it is true. I'm not neglecting that. I'm just saying it doesn't depend on it. OK, any other question? This was quite technical, but I thought it was important to stress this. OK, what does this mean? OK, that's the next point. The next.
So if you change the scaling of C, I mean, is it super sensitive? Does it quickly deviate from 1 if you change any of those assumptions?
There's a formula for that. What are you trying to get?
I don't know. I mean, I'm just wondering, like, if you make lambda p to the power of 1 or 3 or whatever, then how does it change your...
There's an equation, which is, it's continuous, right?
Okay.
It's continuous, that's
right.
If that's a concern.
No, I'm not worried it's continuous, I just wonder, because we know that then it's very close to 1, but...
Okay, we'll get there. Yeah. So one way to do this, so that's the cosmologist's way to do this, okay? So we were writing these, but when I did this, there was no evidence for it being different from 1. So it was funny. And curiously enough, this guy, the D in the ultraviolet doesn't need to be an integer. Curiously enough, the guys who did CDTs, in fact, in Holland, found 2.02, so could be fractal. Curiously enough, if you put that and you choose a radiation equation of state, you get 0.96, but I'm joking. I mean, this is not to be taken seriously. So you could play that game. It's a very cosmologist way of playing games, which is you just fit parameters and you get something. I'll talk about 0.96. It's going to be very important. But for this way, you do get, if you take things face value with the two there, the equation of state drops out and S is 1 exactly. Otherwise, you can play the game.
Right.
Or not.
No, I'm just wondering how sensitive it is to.
There's a formula for that.
So in inflation, there's an additional thing we put in, which is Bunch Davis. And so the reason we take Bunch Davis normally is to say that at infinite negative k, the second term doesn't matter, and you've got the time independent harmonic oscillator, which I can write down the Gaunt states using the quantum measurement and all that. And if you make the CS, it's still obvious that you get that you ignore the Bunch Davis state even more.
So this is weird. This is the weird. The assumption is equally good or bad. I mean, it could be true, could be wrong. If you go to perimeter, if you have any quantum gravity people in the audience, that's the first thing they say to an inflationary talk. You don't know what you're talking about. How do you know the vacuum is Bunch Davis?
So
you don't. You don't. So I don't either. I'm making the same assumption as inflation. Exactly.
The same assumption. So you still are now saying that. It is scaling invariant in some point. But you're saying that there's something, that there is a scaling invariant vacuum state still.
So very importantly, the Bunch Davis vacuum does not give scaling invariance. It gives scaling invariance near the sitter, outside the horizon. Whereas here it gives you scaling invariance immediately, just inside the horizon. And the reason is, it's Bunch Davis, it's WKB, but then Bunch Davis. And it turns out it doesn't matter. You still get this is still true, and you can prove you are in the WKB approximation. So it's a funny, it's an adapted Bunch of Davis, but it is true. You can, even with a varying C.
You can still get
Yeah. It's non-trivial. No, that's what you're right. It's non-trivial that you can prove it. You are in the WKB regime. No, okay, that's true. So another thing you can do is just say thermal fluctuations. Why not? You could just do that. So inflation, you cannot do thermal fluctuations because you're super cool. Here, you could do both. And in fact, the answer is very different. So this is an assumption, too. Okay, what am I going to tell you? Okay, I'm going to just basically tell you, I'm going to run out. This is what I wanted to tell you, basically. You know, for everything else is just an extra comment. So this was very weird. Okay, so we wrote this essay about this stuff, what I'm going to say next, and Tuft wrote the same essay and got the first prize, we got the second prize. And in fact, the essay is very similar, defends exactly the same. So the Gravity Foundation essay won by Tuft this year was exactly about the fact gravity is conformally invariant as you go into the UV. Now, this is actually true here as well. So we wrote a paper independently saying the same thing. And except he was trying to get, his motivation was from renormalization, and effectively how to make gravity renormalized, but from his experience from QCD, non-abelian theories, and the Higgs mechanism specifically. Whereas I don't know. Basically, what I'm about to tell you is just that it's really so simplistic that it's a bit embarrassing, but it's effectively it's the following, okay? So this looks like a miracle. And of course, miracles don't exist. Okay, so here it just happens that you get scaling invariance. Doesn't really matter how, what's the equation of state. It's completely independent, okay? Of the gravity, it's completely independent of the fact the universe is expanding differently for different equations of state. So what happened? So it looks like I assumed Einstein gravity here, which is a massive assumption. And I assume Einstein gravity with a varying C, which is a bit crazy. Okay, let's play the following game. So I told you earlier on, this thing about varying C, constant C, depends on how you look at it. I have different frames. And Brunsdicke was the example I gave you. Now, Brunsdicke, actually, there is an Einstein frame as well in Brunsdicke, which is when it looks like I have a constant, I have Einstein equations, okay? So let's play the same game. I've already played this game to show that this thing represents dimensional reduction. So I changed the units, trivialized the C. And what happened with that? Well, I got the Hausdorff dimension going from 4 to 2. And I always be careful with that game because people always say, you can always trivialize the C. Yeah, but you change everything. So in Brunsdicke, you end up with a fifth force. Here you end up, you change the vertex. You change all the interactions. You change everything. And you change the gravity as well. Okay? So this is the highly non-trivial thing you have to do here. Let's change the units on this action and see what happens. To my E tilde, P tilde. So this is an exercise which is just a bit of algebra. You go through it. So effectively, you can absorb your eta. There's two ways of doing this. You can do it in any mixture. You can put everything in this measure and go from 4 to 2. You can change the time, going from this conformal time to this other time. That's a bit like saying d tau equals c d eta. She's the every referee reported this when I started working on this. Why don't you define the time so that c equals? Of course you can define, but then you end up with a different theory or different equations in other things. So let's play this game here, actually, and see what happens. Well, this is what happens. You end up with an equation in which, so if I use dot here, I've been using different things and put a prime here, since I use the prime there. So, I mean, of course, I get rid of my CS by doing this game. And you just have to basically work out all these various things. You find this is what happens. Square root of C. And now if I plug this guy here in there, and this is in the way, I'm not sure I can move this around without causing a disaster. But basically what you find is that this becomes a constant. Now this guy here, this function here, which appears DNA there, normally it's your Z, right, in your usual equations, is what generates the gene's instability. If this guy becomes a constant, why does it become a constant? Because my CS is proportional to K over A squared. So when I take the square root, the A is canceled. It's the same miracle which happens there. But now I understand better what the miracle means. The miracle means this guy becomes a constant. And basically, my equation in these new units, I've been using primes there, let me use it here, is this. So what's this equation? It's just exactly this one without this. When does this happen, incidentally? So this actually does happen with Einstein gravity for one case. So this is what happens if I put all, basically this is a new theory of gravity which happens in the new units in which I trivialize the dispersion relations. My C becomes 1, my measure shows that I'm going from 4 to 2, my gravity theory just switches off. Because I basically lose the gene's instability completely to second order here. So either I lose gravity or, which is the point I was trying to make, what happens? So this, sometimes this guy is zero. So I'm not putting that to zero, which is what you said. But there's one case in which that is zero, okay? Which is when? Which is your undergraduate course again in cosmology. You do have this equation with usual gravity for one kind of matter. Which is it? When is A double prime over A zero? When is A proportional to eta? You can't say even if you're not in them. It's when you have radiation, okay? So in the usual universe, if I just have Einstein gravity, this does happen, okay? What actually happens if I have pure radiation is that A is proportional to eta. Therefore, my gene's instability switches off completely. Why? Because radiation is conformally invariant. So radiation couldn't care less about the universe expanding or not expanding. So there's no gene's instability because there's no horizon for radiation, because there's no expansion for radiation. So this is very important because another way to phrase it here, when I change the units, is basically to conclude that everything behaves like radiation. So it's a bit as if everything is conformally coupled to gravity. So this is really the kind of the miracle. The miracle here is that somehow gravity switches off. And that's kind of the reason why the equation of state disappears completely. So the assumption really here is the 4 to 2 is that crazy C dependence in P. But regarding the gravity, if I look at things carefully, what I'm really assuming is that basically gravity should be, and in this case it's, you can prove it from Mojave-Lifshitz, but in general, gravity should be conformally coupled to all the matter. Okay, so first comment I want to make, should erase a few things. Where did I put the eraser? No, it's there. So I have 5 minutes, and I promise I won't go over time. I just want to make some final comments on this. So I did mention that this is quite general. So in fact, there are theories like Mojave-Lifshitz, but there are a bunch of theories like asymptotic Einstein gravity, in which my D'Alembertian is basically a power of the usual D'Alembertian, There are things like doubly special relativity or kappa, blah, blah, blah. There's a bunch of things in which I can play with them. I can end up with some modified dispersion relations. Sometimes I must have a modified volume as well. And basically, when I work out the conditions with that game, I do find fortitude. In all of them, if I work out the vacuum fluctuations, I find this. If I have fortitude, if I ignore gravity, I have ns equals 1 in this case. And in fact, the formula is the following. Ns is my d asymptotic minus 1. It's a very simple formula. Okay, I can actually work out that whatever the asymptotic UV dimensionality of space is, it appears immediately. In the NS, this is not so surprising, because really I'm counting modes. That's the thing we talked about earlier on. What am I actually doing with this NS, with this DH? Well, this DH, in a way, is counting things which appear in the calculation. So it's not very surprising that this is such a simple formula.
Can I go back to the question?
Yeah.
So, the fact that the question motion looks like predicts theory when it's like formulating the question is, I think it's basically the fact that the scaling of whatever field with the modified dispersion relation, scaling basically goes to zero. So so the scaling dimension vanishes. So that's why you get something that looks like formulating the question. And that's okay, but is it actually true that there's no genes in PNE?
Yes.
If you do like the full gravitational analysis.
This is to second order, right? So I didn't say anything to cubic order or anything beyond.
I mean, if you fix the background, I'm okay that it looks like an unrelated question, but if you do the full gravitational analysis, I'm not sure whether there's no support.
I'm sure it's not true. In fact, it's not just, I'm not sure, I'm sure it's the opposite is the case. I'm sure there is genes instability to higher order. And in fact, it's good, because basically, this is a second order calculation. So all I'm doing here is making the statement that gravity is conformally coupled to second order. Okay, it's a very different thing. And in a way that's, I mean, basically what happens here is, okay, once you find these, then it looks like what you should be doing is reverse engineering the gravity. And just saying everything, should say gravity is conformal. So genes instability. This is true in Minkowski space-time. If you say gravity is conformally coupled to everything, or everything is conformally coupled to gravity, then this is true outside the horizon as well. And I basically have a mechanism for explaining scale invariance. Okay, but the problem with this, in a way, this is a mixed blessing, right? In a way, it's good because it just says all these theories. In a way, I'm generating different theories of gravity, because of course, if I go to the other frame, in which C is varying, there's no reason why you have Einstein gravity. So that's the first point. That's true for Ojava-Lifshitz. I start with Einstein gravity, I go to the other frame, it's conformal. Now, if I impose conformal and want to reverse engineer it, what happens in the original frame might not be Einstein gravity, and it isn't. So it's really strange gravity, okay? So that's the first thing to say. But in a way, if you play this kind of game, then it's great. But on the other hand, what happens is that you cannot distinguish these theories observationally. So all these theories produce exactly the same result. I have 4-2 with this assumption, which is an extra assumption, okay? I end up with exact scale invariance for all of them, so they're not distinguishable. What's the point? Okay, so first of all, NS is 0.96, as you pointed out. So we have to find a way to actually break this exact scale invariance. Second, the cubic action. Yes, I don't believe the genes instability is switched off to cubic action. So the bispectrum might be discriminative between them. And in fact, we know it is. Okay, different bispectrum. And in addition, I don't want to play the game of just fiddling with, you know, basically going to the numerical errors of people who did CDTs and found whatever, the variation of a few percent in their result and say this is the reason, and I have a fractal dimension and blah, blah, blah. We did play that game, but that's so much a cosmologist game to play. It's just terrible, because it should be a more fundamental thing. And to my mind, the story is the following. I think, and this was exactly the kind of speculation in our essay, maybe gravity originally switched off, and everything is conformally coupled, and the universe is two-dimensional, and it's conformally invariant. But then what actually happens is that you have this symmetry. You must break it, because we don't see it nowadays. And whatever breaks the symmetry is what switches on gravity, unleashes the extra two dimensions, and presumably whatever actually does that and breaks the fundamental conformal invariance explains this as well. So a more fundamental way to do this would be to try and connect quantum gravity theories and actually the specific mechanism by means of which you break these fundamental symmetries to actually get these observables. And I think that would make more sense. But this is kind of speculation. The bispectrum, I think, is interesting, because actually the bispectrum means some of these guys, particularly this one, have this problem. If I don't want to violate Lorentz invariant, I must have a very strange way to add rules. So when I'm adding two things, which are basically the opposite, they're trivial, but when I'm adding three things, I have a non-trivial vertex, an addition. So the bispectrum probably is sensitive to that and can probably discriminate between Lorentz invariants and violations of Lorentz invariants. And to finish, okay, so maybe I should just finish here, but I got so many questions, I think I deserve another minute or two, or do I not? Your decision, okay? I could just stop here. Okay, okay, go on.
Naive expectation would have been that this generic, it may not predict a number, but generically the same argument applies for tensor modes.
That's what I was going to say in the last few minutes. Okay, go on. But you mean relative to the bispectrum or relative
to
the?
Don't you generically get NT of 0 and an R of 1? But the same argument, of course, you're saying the coefficients are predicted, so it's a dimensionless number, but 1 of 1 is.
Okay, so it's exactly the last point I wanted to make. This point here is basically an issue to do with how to distinguish different quantum gravity theories. The issue mentioning now is, could this be better than inflation? Could I actually predict the R? And what is the R, actually? Here, I didn't tell you anything about it. So I didn't tell you anything about amplitude in general, okay? And that's because I was more focusing on NS here. But it turns out that if you do all the calculation, you go carefully, keep track of all the factors and everything, so you do get k cubed, zeta squared, and then if you have 4 to 2, you get a constant here. Turns out the constant is related to this with the power here, which I can't remember. So in other words, the thing which goes from the infrared to the ultraviolet, which goes from 4 to 2, does not need to be the Planck scale, and that length scale over the Planck scale gives you 10 to the minus 5. Okay? Interesting. It turns out that this guy here is also the thing which appears there, right? So at high energies, well, basically, I have lambda p squared, okay? So that's the number which appears there. So whatever appears there is the thing which fixes the amplitude here. So you can ask the question, what is the speed of gravity over the speed of light or of the scalars? And you could have different g's and a different scalar there. So essentially, it could be that you have a scaling of C with p squared, both for gravitons, which is what Ojava meant, okay, and for matter, which is not what he meant, but we run away with the idea. But you could both go like p squared, but with different numbers there. So that this number is not 1. So at high energies, both speeds, light and gravity, go like p squared, but with a constant ratio. Now, because this is the guy which appears there in the amplitude, this gives you the scalar to tensor ratio. Okay? So the scalar to tensor ratio in these theories is the ratio, the UV ratio of the speed of gravity to the speed of light. There's a paper I've never understood. I'm being recorded. I forgot. Okay, so I won't mention what the paper is. There is a paper in which someone, which I won't mention here, actually claimed to have computed this. And basically, from field theory, this number could be related to the number of species in the standard model and so on. So I don't believe that paper is, I don't know. There's many assumptions going in. But it could be that you just say R is a number. Is a number which is actually related to some particle physics number there. And I think in this respect, this is where inflation, this could be better than inflation. First of all, okay, different philosophies, inflation insulates quantum gravity from what you observe. This plugs one thing into the other immediately. I just gave you an example. In fact, was your question. Second thing, I don't want to, okay, shall I say this? Okay. So you probably remember what happened with Bicep 2 and Planck. When Planck results came up, first was evidence for inflation. When Bicep 2 results came out, inconsistent with Planck results, was evidence for inflation. And this is kind of a funny story, because it could be anywhere. So we have NS and R. It could be just about anywhere. I think there's just a regime around here with IR and 1 in which you don't have a model. Oh, I see. There's someone there looking very shocked. No. So basically, there's an idea that it was kind of scandalous. I mean, I went to a conference before the Bicep 2 came out, and I remember clearly pointing out, people were saying this is evidence for inflation, and blah, blah, blah. I said, well, the result could have been there, and it would be evidence for inflation. And in fact, I pointed to where the Bicep thing came out, and then people asked me, how did you know? I didn't, I just pointed out that direction accidentally. And the point is, I could have pointed out anywhere here. And indeed, there will be a model there, with one exception or two. So there are some corners in this parameter space in which I don't have a model. In general, there is a model there. So evidence for something, using the principle that that something is falsifiable, should be not just that that thing has high evidence with regard to the competitor, but as an evidence which is exceptional, had the data been different. And I don't think the Bayesian formalism accounts for this enough, okay? So if I actually come up with something which connects quantum gravity with this ratio and gives you the R, and I say, well, it's this point here and not anywhere there, then this is much more, this is what I meant initially by being observationally advantageous. And that's the last point I wanted to make, which plug into your question. So you can go into questions directly, then, I suppose. I got too many.
I see you relate to the dimension to discordant relation. How guarantee the dimension is integer? Using his spring theory, the Kaplan anomaly constituting the dimension is an integer. In your setup, how you constitute the dimension should be integer?
Doesn't need to be an integer. No.
Does
not.
But it doesn't make sense. It's not integer.
Why not? Because it's just the way it scales. It's just a number. So be careful. This is not a number of coordinates. So I'm not talking about fractal geometry or anything. This is just the thing we're discussing earlier on. I mean, what is this dimension? It's just counting modes. So essentially, I look at bigger and bigger spheres in momentum space, and I want to know how the modes scale with the radius, okay? And that's what I call the dimension. Now, that number doesn't need to be an integer, okay? Which would be the easiest way to get 0.96. I don't think it's the right way to get 0.96. I do think it's whatever mechanism breaks conformal invariance that explains that 0.04.
Okay, another question. What's the dynamics of this thing? What's the dynamics of this discordant relation? What causes this?
What causes it?
Yeah.
So, okay, what can I say? So you can actually compute it from an action, right? So in the case of Ojava Lipschitz, you propose a different action, and you work it out to second order. There you go. The cubic thing is actually not trivial. It's a more complicated thing. But to second order, you just work it out from first principles. In the other cases, well, no, it's just postulated, actually. So what you do observe dynamically is this 4 to 2 in theories which don't even have dispersion relations, such as causal dynamical triangulations. So the way I do things as a cosmologist is starting from it. And just getting on with it, but that's not quite really.
This kind, is the instant model of the coupling QFT, the coupling can be the random coupling can caused by normalization. Is there any theory normalizes that?
Yeah. So these particular guys here, what they do is they look at the renormalization group flow of Einstein gravity, and then look at the fixed points, and they do find this directly. So in this sense, it is running in the sense of particle physics, strictly speaking, right? And then I'm abusing the language, of course, in other cases.
Are there any last questions? Okay, if not, let's thank our speaker.